Oh, this is packed every season. Ah, hello everybody. You know who I am. It's Mark here. We are back at Largo Central Railroad today, and today is Discovery Live Steam's winter meet here at Largo Central Railroad. They usually would be hosting it in the Februarys, but this year they're hosting it this weekend and in January. So there's already trains already set up in the yard or waiting to go, and it's still the morning and people are still arriving to get their stuff ready. So when they get here, we'll go about and help them prep whatever we can, whatever they'll allow us, of course, because some of these engines are privately owned, and have a wonderful day.
When I arrived in the yard, waiting in the steam bays was the main steam locomotive, and what turned out to be the biggest attraction of the day, a 7.5-inch gauge replica of Rio Grande and Southern number 20. The full-size version, being built by the Schenectady Locomotive Works in April of 1899 for the Florence and Cripple Creek Railroad, nicknamed the Bonanza Railroad. It was later sold onto the Rio Grande and Southern in 1915 and ran the line until 1952, when it was then bought by the Rocky Mountain Railroad Club before being donated to the Colorado Railroad Museum in Golden, Colorado, and restored to running order in July of 2020. But before I filmed these shots, there was something else in the workshop that caught my eye. This is the chassis of a 7.5-inch gauge big boy. This is a project that's helmed by one of the volunteers of LCRR. And even if it's just a chassis with no rods on it, it's damn impressive. It'll be even grander once the whole engine is put together. Back to number 20, a couple of volunteers were already there before I arrived, and some were tending to the 10-wheeler in question. So I got a rag and started cleaning it the best I could. Carefully.
Look, I messed with this engine more than you.
Why is that face down?
A few hours later, Jim, the owner of the number 20, had called ahead and gave the order to get the engine ready to be awakened from its slumber. With that, I did some more cleaning on the engine. Again, carefully.
Hopefully, we have visitors start showing up soon.
Yeah.
What's up? I'm still focused here. Cool.
This is actually her older paint scheme when the Colorado Rivers unit first got her.
Nice.
A few minutes later, I decided to change tasks and helped one of the volunteers of the railroad bring out another engine, this one being a lashup of two BNSF diesels, as well as the freight cars it will be hauling for the day.
There's a whole bunch of Christmas stuff in the booth.
Other volunteers had their own engines out, like this small four-axle diesel switcher being driven by Martin here. But soon, other people started to show up with their own engines.
Looks nice.
This is my second cab, because the first cab didn't have this in it.
Yeah.
So I said, oh, let's get all this stuff. So I just did a trade-in last year.
Once it was offloaded onto the transfer table, it was then brought over to the turntable track and then rotated around facing toward the yard gates. Now, keen eyes may realize that this 7.5-inch gauge number 20 isn't fueled by coal. No, this engine is fueled by something that is actually quite common to be used on live steam on this scale. Propane gas. The DNRG stock car, hooked up to the locomotive, houses two propane tanks, which are hooked up to hoses that go through the tender into the firebox. The reason why it's fueled this way is because of the increasing price of coal in the US, in particular in the state of Florida. It still requires a boiler full of water though, so Santino put the hose into the tender tank and turned the tap on. A few minutes later, Jim arrived, and he joined in on getting his number 20 round. This included greasing the inside motion of the locomotive. RG&S number 20 is a two-cylinder locomotive, with the Stevenson internal motion set in between the frames, which in many cases can be a pain for fitters and shop crews on the full-size engine, and engines similar to number 20.
Do you want me to come over there right now?
Finish those up. We're waiting.
To produce the air needed to create a draft in the firebox, an electric blower was fitted to number 20, and soon, once the tender tank was filled, the injectors filled the boiler up, the fire was lit.
Maybe you should do this. Crank this on a little bit. You should get a flame. Oh, I said a little.
While waiting for the boiler pressure to reach the operational temperature, more people arrived with their own locomotives, the first one being a custom-built Keen Railways GP38, number 2006, a battery-powered unit with an onboard sound system. Very similar, actually, to the CSX-200. Second arrival was actually a switcher from the Central Pasco and Gulf Railroad, another 7.5-inch gauge railroad within the state of Florida. They also host their own winter meets with Discover Live Steam. Their event will be in February.
Okay, coupler's open on the engineer car, so... line up.
While number 20 was getting round, Jim then went around and oiled the valve gear.
There's also a little pinpoint here to do it, but there's usually enough room, like, to get it this way.
Unless you have the side rods that, like, not at the 12 o'clock position, then you'd be able to.
Yeah.
And that extra excess, that's to basically, extended life for them.
Yeah, that's the full-time rust proofing.
What, all the excess oil?
Any oil all over the place is rust proofing.
Yeah, basically it helps keep the engine in tip-top condition.
I'm not going to do right.
Soon, the gauge glass started showing that the pressure was starting to build up enough. The effective boiler pressure for number 20 is around 50 psi. After a few minutes, the electric blower was no longer needed and was removed from the chimney. The locomotive's own blower took over from there. And finally, Rio Grande and Southern Number 20 was ready to be rolled out. Once it was moved into the yard, number 20 rolled forward under its own power to couple up with the train it was hauling that day.
Then there was trouble.
Anybody back here?
I have.
Oh.
Both the two lifters
from the track. Oh, yeah, this is a problem.
The loco had managed to come off right on the switch, its middle and rear driving wheels right in between the two tracks. We initially tried to prop it up with three railing lifts and pry bars.
Hang on, Jim.
Alright, we're waiting.
Alright, I'm ready.
Okay, go on up. More on your side.
Until one of them broke. The front pony truck was still on the rails, so we tried putting a re-railing plate in between the loco and tender and reversed the engine onto it.
Stop dragging it with you.
Yeah, somebody's gotta.
That also didn't work. So we moved it to the front of the engine instead.
Pilots on the plate. Yep, you're all right.
You're fine. I think you cleared it.
The pilot is off the plate, the first driver's path on the plate.
The pilot is off the plate, but the pilot is on the rails?
Pilot's on the rails. Okay. The first driver is on the plate.
Okay, all right, we're going to go forward.
Slow. Yes. One, yes. Two,
yes.
One, three.
Yes!
And with a victory secured for the day, Jim drove his steam engine out of the yard. Of course, it wasn't just number 20 that was roaming about the railroad. Other members or guests were running their trains on the main line too. And funnily, there was this little engine running around too. You'd be mistaken for this being an actual steam locomotive when it's static. But if you get closer, you'll realize that this is actually a battery-powered steam outliner. It even has the chain drive in between the frames.
It's almost like a bullied Pacific. Except it's electric.
The CSX 200 was also gallivanting around the line, sometimes with guests or other volunteers riding on the passenger cars. Thank you.
SF Last Shop was also running around with its own freight train. There was even this little battery-operated steeple cab switcher running around too. But, as I said before, star attraction of that day was number 20. But Jim wasn't the only person who had a turn on the engine. Santino was one of the volunteers who was allowed to run the engine on the main line. When lunch hour rolled in, I decided to hitch a ride behind number 20 with Santino at the throttle. The ride to the station? Well, that was something else. Just listen to that. And we have arrived. Before going to lunch, the fire in number 20 was put out. So after the break, it was relit. And then refilled with water from the station's water mains. This was also a good opportunity for a crew change. Another volunteer was given the controls, with Jim supervising him from behind.
Yeah.
This also gave Santino an opportunity of his own. He went to the yard and fetched his Delaware and Hudson box cab. Later on, another volunteer decided to bring out his engine, a galloping goose, but not just any galloping goose. This particular galloping goose, named the Bat Tracker, was the creation of the railroad's chief mechanic, who goes by the nickname Batman by friends and fellow volunteers. It even has its own little Batman figure in the cab.
Oh yeah.
Even after lunch hour, there was still a good amount of people running their trains on the line. So much so that by the time the day ended, the SD card on the camera was completely full.
Top the whole thing off.
After another water stop, number 20 was cleared for another two laps around the track. And boy, did she run like the grand engine she is. But alas, number 20's day out on the line soon came to an end, and it was time to put it back in the shed. Fire was put out, and this time, the steam pressure in the boiler was released. This was by means of the blowdown valves located on the sides of the engine. Watching this procedure is quite the sight.
Okay, you steam, let's go. We're gonna discover you.
When the boiler pressure finally reached zero, number 20 was then put into its berth in the barn shed.
Yeah, I want to plug this thing in.
As the day started to close to an end, the visiting guests loaded their engines back into their trucks, ready to go home. Even as the day winded down, though, we did get a late arrival.
Looks like another SW.
That's a nice way of holding it down, also.
This SW 1500, aptly named the Crow, along with the cars it was going to haul the next day. The SW 1500 was an interesting piece of kit, though.
This is cool. This guy's engine actually is remote operated. The box in his hand is actually the remote controller for the thing, but it's a gas powered. It's a lawnmower motor or an engine.
Hey, I'm coming over there. Yeah, we got everything in here.
So let's see how this does.
Before I left that day, there was one more engine out on the main line though. So I'll show you what I filmed of that. Before I left though, I had heard that the F unit in question had failed on the main line, so Santino brought out Rebecca's 4970 once more, and a few volunteers went out to aid the failed engine. Unfortunately, we don't get to see them off, as at this point, my SD card reached full capacity, So for me, the day ended there. I was, however, able to make it for the second day. I arrived early, so one of the first things I did when he arrived was help Santino out by putting the whistle and trackside signs where their respective placements were. Jim was back again, but this time number 20 wasn't going to be brought out and fired up for the day. So instead, he brought out his DLS number 1998, along with the cars that would be hooked up to it. There was one interesting locomotive that was brought out that day, though. This is Largo Central Railroad's number one. Literally, the first locomotive that was acquired for the railroad. And remarkably, it still works.
There we go.
Seaboard was brought back out again too, as the previous day it was sitting in the siding behind where number 20 had derailed previously.
It won't be needed as warmer clothes.
Batman also got his bat tracker out again.
Bat tracker, leaving the yard.
And Santino scurried around the line with his box cap once more. FEC 714, having been brought back into service after some repairs, was also brought out, hauling a freight train. Rebecca joined in as well, hauling her train, consisting of her own freight cars. We did have a special guest on Sunday, the Vice President of Ridgelife Steamers, another 7.5-inch gauge railroad located in Dundee, Florida. From what I've heard from the volunteers at LCRR, this event is usually the biggest, as their line is a good 7,500 feet long and lots of trains, including steam locomotives, attend that meet every year. Later, I decided to join Santino on CSX 200, acting as his conductor. The journey up to the station went well, but up the line, a problem occurred.
The media always shows up.
CSX 4970 had failed after exiting the tunnel and blocked the main line. Jim was behind her train with DLS 1998. So they coupled up behind and pushed the train back to the yard entrance. Rebecca then guided her stricken train back into the yard. While waiting in the siding, I was offered a ride on the Bat Tracker. Needless to say, how could I resist the offer? Later, the engines were brought back to the yard so that everyone could have a break for lunch.
How far back am I going? All the way?
As much as you want.
Okay. I'm going to level with the 200.
During this time period, the Crow was put on the yard tracks after having some repairs, and was coupled up to its consist.
Oh, that's a neat tool.
But after lunch, something interesting happened. One of the volunteers decided to swap out FEC 714 for Seaboard 4056. When I heard that this was happening, I asked the board members if I could have a go at driving 714 on the main line. Since this wasn't a public run day, my request was accepted. And I fired up 714 and took her out for a drive on the main line for the first time.
FEC 714, exiting the yard.
Driving 714, I made sure to keep three things in mind. Watching out ahead of the track, blowing the horn at the crossings, and making sure that my track speed was within the limit. I also made sure to keep an ear out on the radio for any instances of trouble ahead of me, as Seaboard 4056 was ahead of me at the time with its own goods train.
Like so. Okay. DC 714, clear the station. That is follow up nice and easy. Train coming up behind me, so I might as well build a little more speed onto it. Not too much though, so I try to within the track limit. But so far, so far so good. Not too bad. While we're driving engines like this, even in the steel, everything happens a lot quicker. One wrong move, you gotta react to it a lot faster. You gotta react to the situation a lot quicker than normal. But with this thing, it's pretty simple. That is also a lot of fun.
My first lap around the route was going very smoothly. But further down the line, Seaboard 4056 was having issues.
That's going in a good way though, that's fine. Simply I sit it down so you can let us take another bite out.
The center of attraction all of a sudden too.
Okay, looks like they got it back on the rails, so...
Once 4056 was re-railed, the all-clear was given for trains to advance once more. But then...
Derailed.
Well, I think I spoke too soon earlier.
During the meet? Yeah.
Yeah, this is definitely not good.
We may, you know, put it behind our tractor and stick it.
It had to be on the first run, my first lap around with one of these.
It turned out that the section of track I was on had not been gantigassed properly, as some of the ties were missing screws on the outer portions of the rails, which resulted in the track coming out of gauge when 4056 and 714 rolled over it. As a result, all traffic was halted, and we set to work fixing it up.
I'd have to guess a good 3 mile an hour.
More somebody on the end.
Regardless, I made sure to go slow over that section to prevent 714 from coming off again.
Thank you.
After a few laps, I decided, that's enough. And brought 714 back to the yard. Even though I was finished, there were still some trains out and about. Ironically, a few minutes after I finished driving 714, it was brought back out again to pull 4970 and its train to the tunnel to do some repair work on the track. Back in the yard, Batman decided to put the Bat Tracker away in the barn shed. The owner of the SW1500, the Crow, was also putting his engine and cars away to be taken home. But even with engines being put away, there were still some trains out there. When the repairs on the track were finished, Rebecca then took control of FBC 714 and drove it on the main line. A few minutes later, Batman brought out CSX 200 for a few rounds on the main. LCRR number 1 was also out on the line. Overall, the winter meet here at LCRR was a very enjoyable experience. I had a lot of fun watching the trains as they went around the line, as well as riding behind them. Heck, I even got to drive one, which was a big highlight for me that weekend. The next winter meet that I, hopefully, plan on attending will be at Central Pasco and Gulf. So keep an eye out for any updates on whether I go or not. See you next time.